We're the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling
Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. He who believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever lives and believes in me, the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed. Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, very good evening to all of you, and let me welcome you to the Ruby Church of the Nazarene, particularly those of you who may never have been here before. The circumstances are not the kind that we would have preferred. Nevertheless, God is in control. Dearly beloved, we are gathered today to pay our final tribute of respect to that which was mortal of our deceased loved one and friend, Hallie. To you members of the family who mourn your loss, we especially offer our deep and sincere sympathy, and may we share with you the comfort afforded by God's word for such a time as this. Do not let your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If they were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Let us pray. Almighty God and most gracious Heavenly Father who art in heaven, we come into your presence this evening with hearts that are mourning. Those hearts are heavy with grief. We thank you, God, for the life of Hallie and the persons his life would have touched. And as we come to lay him to rest, we ask you, divine God, that you will comfort those who are mourning his wife and the other members of the family. We know that you said to us in your words that underneath are the everlasting arms. And we commit everything to you, and everything that is done this evening, we ask that it will be done to your highest honor and glory. In Jesus' name. Remain standing as we sing the hymn that is so very familiar to all of us, a hymn that is so very appropriate for a time like this. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roar, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well. Thank you.
I'm going to ask Jack to lay the plan when we come at this time, and she's going to read for the first scripture.
First reading is taken from 1 Corinthians, chapter 15, 51 to 55. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Here ends the first reading.
At this time, we are going to be having a special musical tribute by Almeda Blendman, and after she's finished, we're going to have the eulogy. I'm just sorry, we went ahead of our time. We're going to have the eulogy by Keitha Moore at this time.
Good afternoon. Hallie Augustus Enoch Moore, born January 27, 1948, born to Alfred Swift and Beautiful Moore. Hallie, Daddy, was born in Dixon Village, St. Vincent and the Grenadines. If I could sum my father's life up in four words, it would be family, cricket, music, and strength. My father lived a tough life, losing both his parents during his youth. Being the youngest of his siblings and raised by these same siblings as well. Hallie Moore came to Barbados in the late 1960s as a teenager on a quest to better his life through learning a trade. My father's skill set saw him take great interest and passion in the construction industry whilst always having a love during his spare time for music and cricket. Hallie Moore learned the trade swiftly and elevated his work on many stages. He worked extremely hard. Throughout the years, he has worked on many projects. He was what we call a jack of all trades. His title was a subcontractor, but his forte was steel bending. I'm sure we all have had some interaction with my dad as he either assisted, advised, or developed the houses of many of the his family members and friends. My father worked extremely hard and had a very great appreciation for quality work. His most memorable projects were Haywood's, Hilton, the Queen Elizabeth's Hospital, the Crane, and of course his all-time favorite, Kensington Oval. Hallie Moore, as we know, was extremely passionate about cricket from a young age. He played in the local league in the BCL in the early 1970s. This all changed in 1975-76, where he was given out stumped on 98, two runs short of his maiden test century. In 1976, however, he joined the Barbados Cricket Umpires Association and umpired local cricket. He actually passed the West Indies Cricket Umpires Examination Test in 1985 and made his first class debut as an umpire in 1991, going on to officiate 23 matches. His biggest assignment came when he was appointed as the third umpire for international matches, monitoring the television replays and making judgments on decisions referred to him by the on-field umpires. I can still remember the 1999 series where Sharon Campbell was given a run out after being knocked to the ground and the crowd was throwing bottles onto the field whilst my dad was the third umpire. As a young individual, I was a little scared for my dad whilst being at school. However, he has always been very vocal on cricket since his retirement in 2004, whether it may be making calls in on-call in programs, sending text messages, asking his son to send tweets, talking to players, or general banter with family and friends. Cricket meant a lot to my father, and the performance of the West Indies cricket team, let's not go there. We were quite thankful that they won the two T20 titles. Music. Dad was nothing short of a musical master, a DJ genius, some may say. From his late teen years, he always had a passion for music. Cassettes, records, CDs, flash drives, you name it. It was always in the mix. He was always at Linda's Disco buying the latest. Daddy always had decent equipment, amplifiers, equalizers, turntables, speakers, which all his friends, family members, and even workmates at some point had to lift. He knew what it meant to be a popular DJ. Dad never showed off, but you could tell his musical class. From street parties, school fairs, weddings, crop-over events, just to name a few categories, Dad was musically clever in every aspect of clever. I remember the late Berkeley Jack saying that my dad tricked him all the time. For instance, he would give him old music to play for hours so that when my dad arrives, he just plays new music and the crowd just automatically jumps for the reaction. Dad loved oldie goldies, reggae, soca. He loved Gabby and he loved Beckett. Daddy slowed down with the music since 2004. However, he's never stopped loving or having a passion for music. He always has an ear for a good song and always has Keith and Crystal burning CDs for people. Whilst music was a major part of my father's life, I would have to say the biggest thing in my father's life was family. Nothing meant more to my father than family. Family was everything he could ever ask for. His nieces, his nephews, his sisters, his brothers, all had a special relationship with him. Some members even were led to believe that he couldn't say no. He gave his all for his family, both here in Barbados and back home in St. Vincent, any way he could. Hallie Moore was so sure to make sure that everyone was taken care of, like it was his personal obligation. No one understands how he got it done, taking care of so many people at the same time. Uncle Reliable. Maybe that should have been his name. If I start telling you the family stories, we could be here all night, so I'll just wrap up on that. But one thing's for sure, his love for family was pure. Hallie Enoch Augustus Moore loved all his children equally. I always looked out for all of us, and when I say looked out, I mean looked out. He was the best father any child could ever want. He always had his way of making us all feel special, a feeling that no one could manifest or duplicate. My brothers, sisters all share the same regard, from the eldest all the way to the youngest, even his adopted grandson Hayden. My father met my mother January 13, 1982. Those two have been together through thick and thin, for richer and for poorer, sickness and health. And then they were married in May 7, 2005, in our younger years. Daddy insisted that mommy not work, but stay home and take care of his precious cargo, especially my sister, or as she was entitled, the princess. Daddy shared a lot with us, even though his schedule was always busy because of the two C's, construction, cricket. Daddy taught us a lot about his history in St. Vincent from a young age. He always reminded us the importance of church and prayer. Even though his weekends were pretty hectic, he always made sure my mom took us to church from a young age. I'm also, personally, I can say my father was the best ever, and I mean that. I'm also very, very proud to call him Daddy. He was a man of high caliber, protected us from any obstacles. He appreciated us and wanted his children to find themselves in life, to have more opportunity than he ever did. Daddy was a role model. He always knew the answer to everything, or if he didn't, he would call someone or find some way to get that answer to you pronto. I do miss my father dearly, and I do pray I can be half the man he was. I know we will meet again. I love you, Daddy.
Now there is a song to the back of your program, Through All the Changing Scenes of Life. And by special request, we are going to stand and sing that one now. Through All the Changing Scenes of Life. I'm sorry, it is not Through All the Changing Scenes, it is Jerusalem the Golden. Jerusalem the Golden.
Sure.
be seated. At this time, we'll have a musical tribute by Almeda Blendman.
Good evening, everybody. Glad to see so many of you. But according to the man, I expect this. I am thankful for you all. He was my baby brother. And I'm thankful for the life that he lives.
Sleeping, there came a dream.
We will now have a tribute by Crystal Moore.
Good afternoon. One of the greatest gifts I ever had came from God. I called him Daddy. Daddy fueled my love for many things in this world. My relationship with the Almighty, my love for family, my love for music, and the only aspect I didn't quite pick up on was my cleanliness for vehicles, and we all know how that went. Daddy was the reason I learned to ride. He was the reason I learned to sing. Scrap that. One of the many traits we had in common was our melodic voices, or lack thereof. And he was definitely the reason I learned to drive. I remember one day Daddy said, you could drive the truck to the bottom of the gap. So, you know, I was never supposed to get automatic license. It was manual or nothing. And I was the most excited because, you know, I was 15 and I was driving. And this was the highlight of my evenings. However, a lesson learned quickly was never to learn to drive with family members. By the time I reached the bottom of the gap and I was about to turn around, I was experiencing so much difficulty with manual, and Daddy was nagging me about how much I was doing it wrong. I nicely took off my seatbelt, told him bye, and walked all of 10 steps home. Of course, Daddy brought my bags inside, all the while quarreling about how he can't have a child that cannot drive. The only thing my father and I never disagreed on is that he and I had a distinct similarity, which often led us at loggerheads. Ever so often, our stubborn personalities clashed, and you can be assured that by the next day, Daddy's already calling me Big Nose or Lick Mouth. Because plus two, he needed something from me. Either he wanted me to make tea or he wanted me to fix something on the other with his smartphone. We all knew Daddy stood up for what he believed in, and as long as he had a point, whether it was right or not, once he believed in it, he would argue it to the end. And who could forget Daddy's troublesome personality? He would make it his business to pass a joke about you and bring a smile to your face immediately. Mine was Big Nose, apparently. He had an undying love for children. He fathered so many of us. We could rename him Abraham. I would not ask all of you to show your hands of all he fathers, because each of you know the specific role he played in your life. In turn, I acquired many godchildren. Every time I tell him about my newest addition, all he could say is, another one, Chrissy? But he loved it so much, and since I brought one of them home, namely Hayden, I can never seem to part ways with them. They were absolute definition of two peas in a pod. At first, it was Chrissy Ho Hayden, and Chrissy, I bought a gift for Hayden. And then one day, Daddy called me and told me he saw a bed for Hayden in Price Mart, and to go look at it this evening so he can go back the next day. I knew it was all over from then, and Hayden was moving in indefinitely. Hayden fueled Daddy's love right down to the very last day on this earth. He was as happy as ever to take him to nursery and pick him up from nursery. And the two of them could talk for hours and hours until your ears would bleed. He loved Hayden and would tell him every day. Daddy and I had loads of arguments about music. Mostly the likes of old dancehall, reggae, and of course, calypso. I remember that I was 16 at community college and begging Daddy to take me to school to go to an upcoming Barry show. Daddy inspired my love for Barry, and he would often argue that Glenn Washington had a sweeter voice. Needless to say, after Daddy was tired of me nagging, and trust me, I had an art, he finally agreed for me to go. And of course, Keita had to chaperone me, as I was never gonna go by myself. Every year, June to August, he would argue and compare notes. We would argue and compare notes about soca music, current years to present. Calypso was our everything and one of our greatest bonds. And even though I thought Daddy would never allow me to jump Kaduma, two years ago, I finally did it. Despite the fact that he took me to Bank Hall every year Kaduma to see the display of bands. The idea of me jumping in with them was completely unorthodox. Of course, I looked for the most covering outfit, and even then, I skipped to the dirt early o'clock. Rest assured, though, Daddy was on Black Rock Main Road with the Vincentian Association, and of course, when my band passed, he was up front. After Daddy no longer could actively participate in umpiring cricket, he became an avid cricket spectator. No matter where or when cricket was playing, he was watching. And even when there were those crazy time zone changes, he would be up at 5 o'clock to get 1 hour sleep to get ready to go to the Heart Foundation, where he absolutely loved. He ate, slept, and breathed cricket. He could spew facts about cricket like the West Indies Cricket Board. Matter of fact, even better. I remembered being very young and crying at the gate for daddy when he was leaving for only a week or a weekend to go umpiring cricket in a neighboring island. Rest assured though, when daddy was coming home, he was always packing a gift for Keita and I. Even if it was a sweetie he picked up from the departure lounge, it was enough to make us happy. I even remember daddy constantly quarreling about how he's never watching another West Indies match. But of course, every single time, he knew the time and place matches were playing, and he was always troubling Keita to stream it online for him. From a very tender age, daddy used to put Keita on one side and me on the other side of his huge stomach. And I sat and we would read stories every single night. Daddy was very big on academics. I remembered being accepted into the University of the West Indies late, which was based heavily on the fact that I changed my degree last minute. And I remember the day I got my acceptance letter, he was like, "Crystal, if you didn't get into the university, you would see." He's very strict. He believed so much in academics, and he was secretly waiting all those late nights I spent at the university and made sure the vehicle he gave me was, of course, gassed up and no doubt sparkling. One thing I could attest is my father loved my mother, and stories of their courtship and the way he wooed her always made me love the concept of love. In all my wildest dreams, all my fantasies of my wedding day, all I could ever envision is me and my beautiful white dress, my family, and my daddy walking me down the aisle. Daddy and I had a special relationship, being the last girl. And if anybody knows how protective fathers are of their daughters, my daddy was tell a thousand times that. Even earlier this year, he was really upset I sustained some bruises at gym because the scarring was going to be ridiculous, he said. As a young child growing up, there is no comparable measure a girl can have to her father. At a very tender age, when mommy would bathe me and put me in my prettiest outfits, I would eagerly wait at the door with childlike anticipation for daddy to get home from work. As soon as he walked through the door, I was there to meet him with a smile and hugs and kisses. If he didn't immediately tell me I was the prettiest girl in the world, I would be instantly depressed. One evening, daddy came home, and somehow in his rush to greet all of us, he forgot to tell me how pretty I was. Straight to the bedroom I went, off my clothes were, because I had to find another outfit so daddy could tell me how pretty I was. And of course, tears ensued. Needless to say, daddy never made that mistake again. Daddy treated me like a princess all my life, never once missing an opportunity to tell me how much he loved me, especially when I was young. Daddy defied all odds. The only guy I know who could withstand a major heart attack in style and grace. And even with the core of the heart he was living with, he had an undying love for everybody he came into contact with. Daddy always told me he worked hard so he can give his children a better life than he had. And he swung gold from this hard life. A father is a son's first hero and a daughter's first love. Daddy is resting with the angels, and without a doubt, he's giving one of them or all of them loads of trouble. Rest easy, Daddy. Love you.
We now have the second scripture reading. Would you please stand for the reading of the scripture? And Wayne Graves is going to be reading that scripture.
The second Bible reading is coming from Psalms 46, verses 1 to 7. God is our refuge and strength, a very pleasant help in trouble. Therefore, will not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake and the swelling thereof. There's a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. The heathens raged, and the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Here ends your reading.
We remain standing for the singing of a hymn, Blessed Assurance. Tribute from Karima Holder.
Thank you.
this special song, we're going to ask the person from the BCA and the BCUA to come at this time and give their brief tribute.
Good afternoon to all. My name is Stephen Leslie. I am the representative this afternoon from the Barbados Radio Association. I want to first say that when we were afforded the opportunity to say a few words with Hallie Moore, it came as a personal opportunity. I first met Hallie back in 1997 while playing a cricket game at the Lord's School. And I recall having an incident which the rules came into question, and one of the interesting things about Hallie, which I've taken through my life, is that while we were debating, wondering what we should do based on the rules, he came to me and he whispered during the break, in everything you do in life, you must put the human touch. Don't mind the laws, don't mind the rules, remember the human touch. And that meant a lot to me, because here were some words saying, this is the person who should be the winner, this is the loser. But Hallie understood the importance of having that human touch. I would want to also say one other opportunity that he actually presented to me without him even knowing. Back in 2003, I was talking with a young lady. She came from Arnestville in St. Vincent. And I wasn't so sure if I should take the opportunity to make her my wife. And I said, of all the persons that I've interacted with in my life, is there someone from St. Vincent I can talk to get some advice from? And it was Hallie Moore. And I can say that the advice he's given me today, we're still together and we're happy. And one of the things that he said, again, is that he said, you cannot choose the family that you have, whether it's an extended family or the brothers or sisters. You can choose your associates. You can choose those people who you interact with. And that meant a lot again to me, because it meant that if I had chosen that young lady as my wife, whatever came from that, I had to give 100%. And I want to thank the family again for giving us at the Barbados Great Association the opportunity to say a few words from the organizational standpoint. On behalf of the entire board and the members of the BCA, we want to extend our condolences. And I can say that from the family perspective, I know it's not easy to empathize, because you're feeling it obviously more than some of us, but I want to suggest that what you do in the next few days and weeks, allow it to be something that Hallie will be very proud of, and something that he can also look back or look down and say that all of the efforts that he put in were not fruitless. Thank you again.
Good evening to everyone. First, on behalf of my family, the president, the officers, and members of the Barbados Cricket Umpires Association, I do extend deep condolences to Mrs. Donamore, the wife of Hallie, also his children, his immediate family, relatives, and friends. I found Hallie to be a person of high extreme character in every respect. When I joined the Barbados Cricket Umpires Association, I met Hallie, and at that time, he was one of the senior umpires in the association. He gave me great inspiration and encouragement to progress up the ladder in my umpiring career. Many a times, he would give me tips on how to handle the many controversies that come with umpiring, and for that, I am eternally grateful. When I did reach the level of being a first-class umpire, he was extremely happy for me. I am eternally grateful. He loved the BCA, and he always wanted to see its members reach the top level. As for the association itself, he wanted it to progress to be one where it could function on its own so much that when he became a member of its committee of management, he personally took on the responsibility as chairman of the fundraising committee and making all efforts to raise funds, so much so that he used his own finances and other means to construct a bar at Kensington Oval when international matches were on. He even brought his music set from home to play after cricket was finished on evenings, just to keep patrons at the bar so they would spend some money to put in the association. I must say that he was also a very kind-hearted person and would always go out of his way to help anyone whom he could assist. He would many a times come to the aid of persons whom he did not even know to make sure they were all right. He very much disliked seeing anyone being treated unfairly, no matter who that person was, and I think he will always be remembered for that. He was also a very humble man, such was him. As I close this short tribute to my former umpiring colleague and friend, I will use two words that he will be familiar with, time and play. The top umpire from above has called time on your innings in this match, but he has now also called play in a new innings for you, which he knows best. May you enjoy this innings with eternal peace and rest until we meet again. Thank you.
I have been informed that the rain clouds are gathering, so for persons on the outside, don't stay there and get wet. There is a building to my back. If you go around that side, there's a building behind me where you can shelter. We will now have the tribute from Ms. Karima Hould.
Good evening to everyone. His strength is powerful.
Carry us when we can.
to speak to us and to bring our message this afternoon is the Reverend Dr. Samuel Elcott.
Thank you so very much, Sister Callis, and I want to again say a very pleasant evening to all of you. And I want to offer my sympathy to Donna, all the other members of the family, on behalf of the Board of Administration here, my own family, and the general membership here at the Ruby Church of the Nazarene. Father, we want to say thank you. We want to say to you how much we love you. And this evening, as we mourn with those who are mourning, thank God that they are mourning, but the one who's passed away has died with a hope. And we say thank you. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. For just a few moments, because we are going to be constrained by time, I want to share with you my thoughts this evening. I'm sure that all of us are gathered here. For some of us, we would say that we came to pay respect to the deceased. And then there are those who would say they came to celebrate the life of the deceased. I'm sure that as we reflect on the life of Brother Hallie Moore, he would have meant something to all of us. As a matter of fact, when I was asked to have this service here at Ruby, I played second division cricket, and I immediately checked my files to ensure that he never gave me out wrongfully. Otherwise, it may have been a little bit different. But thank God I do not think he ever umpired a match that I played in, so I have no unkind remarks to say about him. So may he rest in peace. I'm sure that for Donna, she may say to us that Hallie was the love of her life. For the children, I'm sure that as they would have said in the eulogy, that he was the best daddy that has ever lived. For his colleagues in the Cricket Association and the Umpire Association, I'm sure that as they would have already made their tributes, it speaks to the kind of man that Mr. Moore has been. And for his siblings, I'm sure that they would say, we've lost a brother. And for most of you, you may say you've lost a friend, a good man. But one of the things you must ask yourselves is, despite all of the comments that has been made and all the tributes that would have been made, what is the state of Mr. Moore? He deceased. He's dead. So all that he would have done, all that he would have said, has now gone into history. What is really the thing called death? Death is really a cessation, if you were to look at it biologically. It's either temporary or complete stopping of all biological functions that sustain the organism. Death in itself is an extremely sad moment for some of us. Very unpleasant. For those persons who have experienced death, particularly if it is someone very close to you, it is not a good feeling. Very sad. Tears you apart. And it becomes worse when the person who's passed away has touched your life and means so much to you. You see, when a person dies, it brings to an end all of the social and familiar bonds that that person would have done over the years. That is now ceased. It's no longer in existence. But from a Christian perspective, death came as a result of the fall. And I'm sure all of you who would have attended Sunday school and church, you are familiar with the story of Adam and Eve. The fall in the Garden of Eden, where in Genesis chapter 3, verse 17, God said to Adam, that the day he ate of that fruit of the knowledge of good and evil, he would surely die. You know the story quite well. Adam was in the garden quite comfortably. God came down in the cool of the day and spoke with Adam. Then God said that it was not good that man should be alone. He made it help me, and so Eve came. And you know the story quite well when the serpent interrupted with Eve and convinced her that the fruit was good to be taken, and she ate and also gave to Adam. It seems to me as though you ladies still has got that same influence on us all like today. Still has that influence. But the problem has to do with the fact that as soon as Adam ate that fruit, it resulted with sin and death. Adam was thrown out of the garden, and right at the entrance of the garden, angels were placed to prevent him from going back in. So he lost that relationship with God. He lost the one who would have come in the cool of the day and spoke with him. You see, God never intended for us to experience death. And so therefore, the impact of sin means that the relationship between man and God, as it was in the Garden of Eden, they were separated now. And so therefore, God had to seek for a way to bring that relationship between himself and man together. And so therefore, through the birth of Jesus Christ, he gave his life on Calvary's cross for us. And so therefore, the relationship between man and God, that bond was restored. And that's why we say in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. You see, so serious was the mistake Adam made in the Garden of Eden, which impacts our lives today. We call it sin. We call it disobedience, whatever you choose to call it. But it has impacted our lives so much that it has caused death. As a matter of fact, if you understand the scriptures well, those of you ladies who would have borne the pain of giving birth in the hospital or otherwise, I have happened to have gone to the hospital on numerous occasions in the past by that ward B2, or whatever ward it is. You do not have to see the mark on the wall to identify which ward it is, because the songs that come from there tells you it's a very dread ward. The Bible says to us that as a result of sin, even you ladies who give birth to children, you've got to go through pain and that agony, the pain of giving birth. The Bible says to us in John 14:1, man that is born of woman has but a short time to live, and full of trouble. He cometh forth like a flower and is cut down. He fleeth also as a shadow and continueth not. So as a result of this sin, as a result of death, all of these things have come upon man. The Bible says to us in Genesis 3:19, in the sweat, by the sweat of your brow, you will eat bread. As a matter of fact, originally, Adam was in the garden. He ate of the fruit, and the rain that we experience that falls upon us never impacted Adam, because the rain never came down. All the trees that were in the garden, none of them were faced with sprinkler, because you see, underneath of the ground, there was an irrigation system that water came up and not down. The sun never affected Adam because there was a protection over his head. So all of the heat that we experience now never would have impacted on Adam, because God had designed it that way. As a result of Adam's sin and death, all of the things that we are faced with now is a result. But when we die, when we are laid to rest, as Hallie is right now, one of the questions that most persons ask themselves is this the end? I have got a revelation for you. I don't know what theological perspective you may be of. I don't know what theological perspective you may be of. But there are persons who are of the view that when they are dead, they are done. Let me say this to you. Every one of us has got to stand before the judgment seat of Jesus Christ. Doesn't matter to me what your perspective may be, what your theology may be, Every one of us has got to stand before God to be judged. The book of Revelation says, I saw the dead more small and great standing before God to be judged. The Bible reminds us that the life that we are living now is not our own. It's been lent to us by God. And so therefore we have got to live our lives in a way that when God calls us, we are able to say to him, well done. He will say to us rather. And so therefore my understanding is that Brother Hallie would have been a part of our church where he gave his life to Jesus Christ. And so therefore when we mourn for him, we are not mourning as though we are mourning for someone without a hope, but thank God we are mourning for one who has got a hope in Jesus Christ. And that is the most significant to me, because regardless to who we are, regardless to the kind of accolades that are placed upon us, regardless to the letters that are placed under our name, the time will come when we will have to answer God for our deeds. I do not have the time this evening to really go into the sermon as I would have loved to. But one of the things I can assure you about is this. The Bible says to me that to be absent in the body is to be present with the Lord. Let me assure you, the book of Thessalonians says to us, the persons in Thessalonica were concerned about those persons who were dead before Jesus returned. And the Apostle Paul assured them by saying that those who die in Jesus Christ will never be restricted, because Paul said, I heard the sound of trumpets, and the Apostle Paul said that the dead in Christ shall rise first. And so therefore they will always be with the Lord. I don't know what you, as a matter of fact, let me tell you this, I have never preached to a dead man yet. My concern is about you that are living. And I want to suggest to you this evening, I'm sorry I did not have the time. But I want to suggest to you this evening that from my understanding, Brother Hallie, even though he loved to cricket, he loved his children, he loved all the things he had loved, it is of significant importance that he loved Jesus Christ. And I tell you this, I have had the experience of officiating at so many funerals. And I've seen some persons, I really commend the funeral director for the beautiful face that they have been able to do with those faces. I've seen persons never wore makeup, they had on some. Persons who've never worn lipstick, their face has looked beautiful. But I tell you this, the Bible says to me, Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. And I will go and prepare a place for you, and I will come myself. Not trusting anybody else to come. I am coming myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. I am happy, I'm excited to know that even though this life may be difficult, this life may be challenging, the difficulties of this life confuse us, I thank God that there's coming a day when no heartache shall come. No more cloud in the sky. No more light bill. Amen. No more water bill. Amen. Flood, no problem. None of those problems. Because no grave shall hold my body down. When the trumpet shall sound and the dead in Christ shall rise, no grave shall hold my body down. So we can afford to be excited this evening, particularly those of us whose lives are in Jesus Christ. We can afford to be confident in the fact this afternoon that as long as our lives have been surrendered to Jesus Christ, even though we are laid in a casket, this is just the body, the remains. But when God bursts those beautiful clouds, when the roll is called up yonder, when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more. Oh, I bless God this afternoon. There are persons who have asked me for a long time, and I will never forget. I was much younger at the time, and a lady asked me, how come that a young man like you could be a priest so young? Her perspective was, you've got to wait until you're old to serve God, see? But I'll tell you this, it pays to serve Jesus. It's so sweet to trust in Jesus. Just to take him at his word. Jesus, Jesus, how I love him. How I prove him over and over. And I'm suggesting to you that those of you who have never given Jesus Christ a chance in your life, you need to do that. Life is changing and continues to change. And the more experience we have in this life, the more difficult and challenging it is. But I want to say to us this evening, to Donna and all the other members of the family, you are going to miss your husband. You're going to miss your dad. You're going to miss your brother. You're going to miss your friend. The Cricket Association would miss Hallie. But you know where? He's in a better place. He's in the arms of Jesus. And so therefore we can be comforted with those words. I will lift up my eyes to the hills. From where cometh my help? My help cometh from the Lord who has made heaven and earth. Hallie has gone to be with the Lord. He's fought good fight. He's finished his course. He's kept the faith. Henceforth, there's a crown of righteousness that is laid up for him. And finally, even though we have come here this afternoon to celebrate and show our respect for Hallie, the question has always been asked, who is next? Who is next? And if God calls you, would you be able to say, well done? Would you be able, when you examine your life, would he say to you, well done? If you have not yet given your life to Jesus Christ, if coming to Hallie's funeral this evening and reflecting on his life, if when you think about him and what he would have done on this earth that has impacted you, if there's something that he would have done that continues to impact you, which of us are prepared to carry on his legacy? His daughter spoke glowing about him. His son spoke about him. And I have no doubt that based on the response we've had, that he's impacted several people's lives. I want us to examine our own lives. When you die, what will be said about you? Is the life you're living, is it worthwhile or is it worthless? But I thank God this afternoon that regardless to who we are, God can change our lives. God can transform our lives and God can make something out of nothing. God can transform your life and make you something. And when others thought that you are nothing, God is able to transform your life so that others will say, there's no secret what God can do. Are you not happy with the presence of God this evening? Are you not excited to know that regardless of what happens, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know who holds the future. And life is worth living because he lives. We've got very limited time, so I'm going to have to stop. But I trust this evening as we reflect on Brother Hallie's life. And Donna, as you and the girls and Keith and the others go home, you can say, I had a good husband. Are you shaking your head? You approve that? Right. Her daughter smiles, and I don't think you can say to these children anything other than that. So you are now in charge. It has always been said that the man is the head of the home, but when this happens, the woman now becomes the head. I'm sure that as you reflect on his life, as you reflect on the things you would have discussed, as you reflect on the first day you would have met him, and I don't know what words he said to you, but whatever words he chose to say, he won. And thank God, and you, the children, other members of the family, I want to assure you that underneath are the everlasting arms. God is our refuge. He's our strength, and he's ever present in time of trouble. So I want for you to be comforted with the fact that God is in control, and he has promised that he will never leave us nor forsake us. I'm going to ask you to stand with me at this time. As Pastor Robert Smith, the pastor of the church that Hallie would have attended, he's going to pray for the family. I'm going to ask all the members of the family to gather close around the casket at this time. Wherever you are, just around the casket, you can place your hands on it for the last time. And Pastor Robert Smith is going to come and lead us in prayer as he prays for the family in this very difficult time.
Thank you, Pastor. Come on around. Come in as close as you can. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, I thank you. 12 years ago, Hallie Moore bowed his head in the hospital bed there in the ICU room, asking Jesus Christ to become his Savior. I thank you, Lord, that he lived for you. I thank you, Lord, for the testimony he left behind, the people he helped, his wife he loved, his children he loved dearly, and many other people he influenced. Lord, I pray that you might give Miss Donna strength, help, for Keita and Crystal, uplifting for his extended family, sisters and brothers, in-laws, family, friends, that you might bless each and every one, strengthen them at this time and the days ahead. Because even though today is the service and the funeral and the burial, many days are coming. There'll be days sometimes of loneliness. And our comforter, we need you to come. May you bless them. May you encourage them. May you uplift them. Lord, I pray for those who are here. Maybe they have never trusted Christ as their Savior. Hallie did. I saw him do it. Lord, I pray that his friends and family who maybe have not done so, that they would follow the example that he set for them, and they too would trust Christ. Lord, I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
At this time, we will be singing the hymn "When We All Get to Heaven." And during the singing of this song, an offering will be received for the upkeep of the church.
Okay, just as soon as we are finished with the offering, we're going to follow some instructions. We're going to have all the chairs that are down the aisle removed. We're going to give to those persons who will not have seen Hallie just a brief moment to see him, but we want it to be done orderly. As soon as the offering has been received, the ushers will come and they will remove all the chairs, and then we want you to orderly view the remains so that those persons who were not able to see him earlier will see him after the offering has been received. Okay, you're going to come up this aisle, and then you are going to go this way or that way, but you're not going to go back down the aisles. Either way you're going to take, but you're not going to go back down the aisle. It will cause this confusion. Thank you.
Mansions bright. I'm an heir of salvation, purchased of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story.
Spell, and I know. know that he watches.